Come on and make a joyful noise unto the Lord. All ye lands, serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Come on and enter his gates with thanksgiving. Where you are right now, come on, make that his habitation and enter his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him. And somebody open up your mouth and bless his name. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting. And his truth endures to all generations. Come on, this is the generation of them that seek you, O God, that seek your face, O God of Jacob. This morning we seek you. God, we desire to know your ways. And so, God, we worship you in the beauty of your holiness. We give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endures forever. Come on and recognize him this morning. Recognize that he is Lord over your life. Hallelujah. Give him the glory that's due unto his name. Give him the glory that he deserves. Come on, open up your mouth and exalt him. Worship him in the beauty of holiness. Cry out and shout, thou inhabitants of Zion. For great is the Holy One of Israel. In the midst of thee, the Lord in the midst of thee is mighty. He will save. He will rest in his love. He will rejoice over you with singing. Come on and bless the Lord. Come on and bless the Lord. Hallelujah. For the Lord our God is a great King. He is the King of glory. He is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. Father, we bless your name right now. Right now we worship you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Will I always trust?
praise him, praise him, praise him, praise him. Jesus, blessed Savior, oh, he's Jesus, blessed Savior. Jesus, blessed Savior, he's worthy to be praised. Come on and bless him. Hallelujah. Glory to his name. Hallelujah. The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice. Let all the earth rejoice. He wrapped himself in light, and darkness tried to hide. It trembled at his voice, trembled at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me. How great is our God? All will see how great is our God. And age to age he stands, and time is in his hand, beginning and the end. Beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one. He's the Father, Spirit, and Son. The Lion and the Lamb. The Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God. Yes, sing with me. How great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. Oh, how great is our God. Sing with me. How great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. For you're the name above all names, and your word. Oh, my heart will sing, how great is my God. Yeah, you're the name above all names. Jesus, you are worthy of all praise. And so my heart will sing, great is our God. Yes, you're the name above all names. or praise, and my heart will sing a sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. Oh, how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. How great is our God, and sing with me how great is our God. All will see how great is our God. Come on, lift your hands and sing it one more time. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great. Great is our God.
Come on, let us magnify the name of Jesus together. The songwriter said, how great is our God. He cannot be compared to no one else, because he is God alone. He is the God that made the heavens and the earth. He is the God that laid the world in its place. He is the God that woke you up this morning. He is the God of the living. He is the God who says, let there be, and there it was. We serve a mighty God, and we have a right to give him praise, glory, and honor. I don't know where you are right now. I don't know what you're going through, but I pray that you will push past your circumstance, push past how you feel, and just begin to give God praise, glory, and honor. Because he is worthy of every praise. He's worthy of every glory. He's worthy of every honor. The psalmist says, I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in him will I trust. I dare not trust in any other, but in the name of Jesus. And when I trust in that name, I am reminded in Psalms chapter 1, where the psalmist writes and says, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seats of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, in which he meditates day and night. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth in its season. His leaf shall not wither, and whatsoever he do shall prosper. While things may be dying around you, the Lord reminds us that our leaves shall not wither in this season. You will not wither in this season. You will not wither in this season. And the reason why you will not wither in this season is because of where you're planted. You're planted by the rivers of water. And because you're planted by the rivers of water, you will bring forth its fruit in its season. Your leaf shall not wither, and whatever you do shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind drives away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. Praise the name of the Lord. I want to take this time to wish every mother happy Mother's Day. You deserve it. Amen. You deserve it. You deserve every gift. You deserve every love. You deserve every appreciation in this season. Amen. We just want to thank God for you. We want to thank God for all of his people. We want to thank God for allowing you to tune into this ministry. Amen. I pray that God would continue to bless you as you listen. I pray that God would give me a word for you in this season, that your life will be transformed and that the will of God will be done in your life. Once again, thank you for tuning in to Church of Champions. We thank you and we love you. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to 1 Kings chapter 17. 1 Kings chapter 17. Reading from verse 1 to 15. 1 Kings chapter 17. Reading from verse 1 to 15. Once again, those who are listening to us from by way of YouTube and Facebook, or even by our website, I just want to say again, thank you for allowing us to come into your home in this hour. And Elijah the Tishbite of the inhabitants of Gilead said to Ahab, "As the Lord God of Israel lives, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years except at my word." Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, "Get away from here and turn eastward and hide by the brook Cherith, which flows into the Jordan. And it will be that you shall drink from the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to feed you there." So he went and did according to the word of the Lord, for he went and stayed by the brook Cherith, which flows into the Jordan. The ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning, and bread and meat in the evening, and he drank from the brook. And it happened, after a while, that the brook dried up, because there had been no rain in the land. Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, "Arise, go to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and dwell there. See, I have commanded a widow there to provide for you." So he arose and went to Zarephath, and when he came to the gate of the city, indeed a woman was there gathering sticks. And he called to her and said, "Please bring me a little water in a cup that I may drink." And as she was going to get it, he called to her and said, "Please bring me a morsel of bread in your hand." So she said, "As the Lord your God lives, I do not have bread, only a handful of flour in a bin and a little oil in a jar. And see, I am gathering a couple of sticks that I may go in and prepare it for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die. And Elijah said to her, do not fear. Go and do as you have said, but make me a small cake from it first and bring it to me. And afterward, make some for yourself and your son. For thus says the Lord God of Israel, the bin of flour shall not be used up, nor shall the jar of oil run dry until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth. So she went away and did according to the word of Elijah. And she and he and her household ate for many days. The bin of flour was not used up, nor did the jar of oil run dry, according to the word of the Lord, which he spoke by Elijah. And somebody say amen. I would like to speak to you from the thought this morning, direction for the season. Direction for this season. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your Holy Spirit. We thank you, God, for allowing us to be here another day, God, to magnify your name. We thank you, God, for clothing us in our right mind and starting us on our way. We pray, God, that even now as I bring forth this word, I pray that you'll touch my lips, that you'll anoint me today. Anoint the ears of your people that they may hear what thus saith the Lord. I pray that your divine will be done. And let everyone say in Jesus' name. Amen. Direction for the season. As we move forward into what is considered a new normal, we are told by officials to be cautious and are given measures on how we are to operate and conduct ourselves as our nation begins to reopen. We are told that if we don't adhere to these mandatory guidelines, that there will be consequences as a result of our actions. Consequences such as spikes in infection, more deaths, possible fines, and even imprisonment. There is no doubt that there are questions about the origin of this virus. Was it man-made or God-sent? And I'll leave it at that. We must understand, nevertheless, that the enemy of humanity will always create smoke screens to push and implement his agenda. We are told in Ephesians 6 to put on the whole armor of God, that we may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Wiles is defined as a devious or cunning stratagem employed in manipulating or persuading someone to do, yes, what one wants. I'm going to say that again. Wiles is defined as a devious or cunning stratagem employed in manipulating or persuading someone to do what one wants. In other words, the enemy works in such a way that it's so devious that if you don't have on the whole armor of God, you won't know you're being controlled. As believers, we need to be cognizant and know that the Antichrist, the evil one, is utilizing his networks on earth to bring the one world order into order with its one world religion. We must not take for granted the day and time we are living in, because unification of religion has never been the will of God. I'm going to say that again. Unification of religion has never been the will of God. God said to Israel, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no other God before me. Can I tell you that every time that Israel disobeyed this commandment and others and refused, amen, to abide by God's word. The Bible lets us know, amen, that something happened to them. God, anytime we refuse to heed to God's word, anytime we refuse, amen, to humble ourselves to God's word and turn from our wicked ways, there are consequences to be paid. In the text that we read, we find Elijah, the spokesperson of the Lord, telling Ahab, the king of Israel, as the Lord God of Israel lives before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years except at my word. Yes, when God speaks against a nation or a person and declares what he is going to do, that's called judgment. When God executes judgment, it means that you have refused to change direction from the path you're on. The Bible says that the Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and plenteous in mercy. Therefore, it takes a lot to get God angry. When God gets angry and executes judgment, it's a clear indication that you have pushed him to the point where he says, enough is enough. Oh God, do you understand how merciful God is? Do you understand, amen, how loving God is? Oh God, the Bible said in the book of Lamentation, it says, through the Lord's mercy, we are not consumed because his compassion fails not. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. God, yes, it takes a lot to get God angry. Every morning you wake up, God is giving you new mercy. Every morning you wake up, God is giving you another chance. Every morning you wake up, God is resetting, amen, what you did yesterday and is giving you another opportunity to make it right with him. We have to understand that we serve a merciful God, a loving God, because if God was not merciful, if God was not loving, oh God, the Bible tells us that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. And so if any time I sin, amen, what should happen to me should be that I would die immediately. But God, amen, loves me so much. God loves you so much that he suspends the death sentence and allows you to live even though you are a sinner. Come on, somebody. Amen. Sometimes we walk around like we got it together, but we got to remember that it's God's mercy that is keeping you alive. It is God's grace that is keeping you alive. Yes, you might be an atheist. It is God's grace that is keeping you alive. You might be a murderer. It is God's grace that is keeping you alive. Oh God, whoever you are, a fornicator, it is God's grace that is keeping you alive. Everything that we have done, amen, all the sins that we have committed, we should have died, amen, when we committed those sins. But the grace of God said, not yet. I'm giving them another chance. I'm giving them a second chance. Come on, somebody. We ought to give God praise for a second chance. We ought to give God praise for his mercy, amen, and his loving kindness. Because if it had not been for the Lord on our side, where would we be? Ahab had caused Israel to sin in such a way that God said, enough is enough. He walked in the sins of Jeroboam. He married Jezebel, the daughter of Ethbaal, king of the Sidonians. He went and served Baal and worshiped him. He built an altar for Baal in the temple of Baal, which he had built in Samaria. In other words, he went to Samaria. In fact, he went, amen, to the Sidonians empire, and he learned how to worship Baal. He took the practice of what he saw and he brought it into Israel and built an altar and a temple in Samaria. And he brought that worship, amen, from the Sidonians to Israel. And the Bible says that not only did he do that, but he made a wooden image. He brought different religion under Israel's umbrella. And this was a no-no in the sight of God. Because of Ahab's actions, the Bible lets us know that the heavens was closed to him and Israel. Nothing came down and nothing went up. When God shuts the heavens, when God shut access to his throne, when God shut off the blessing, there is no way, amen, that you can get what God has. Because once God closed the door, it's closed. Until he reopens it. Amen. And so, God, Ahab, Lord God, the heavens over him became closed because of his actions. The heavens over him and underneath him became closed because of his decisions. And not only, amen, did it affect Ahab, the king of Israel, it infected the whole nation of Israel. Yes, that's why I say it is important that every mother and father understand that your decision, amen, have consequences. It does not only affect you, but it affects your children, and it affects your children's children. We got to understand, amen, that God is a God who sees all things. Nothing we do in secret. God is light, and so he sees everything that we do in secret. God. And so God spoke through Elijah and said to Ahab, there shall not be dew nor rain these years except at my word. It ain't going to come no other way. But by the word of God. It doesn't matter who you go. It doesn't matter which doctor you go to. Once God shut a thing down, it is shut down. Amen. You can go to the opium man. You can go to the witch doctor. If God says no access is granted. Come on, somebody. Notice, he spoke judgment to Ahab, but direction to Elijah. He said to Ahab, there shall not be dew nor rain these years except at my word. Those were proclamation. Those were judgments that were being pronounced to Ahab and Israel. Notice when God said this, he said, amen, to Ahab, I'm going to shut it down. And that was judgment. But notice, amen, what he said to Elijah. He said to Elijah, according to the text, it says, then the word of the Lord came to him saying, get away from here and turn eastward and hide by the brook Cherith, which flows into the Jordan. And it will be that you shall drink from the brook. And I have commanded the ravens to feed you there. He gave direction to Elijah in a season of drought. But in order for Elijah to be sustained, he has to go where God is directing. He can't pick and choose where he wants to go. God, some of us are very picky about, amen, where we want and what we want to do and where we want to go. But if we're going to be sustained in a time of drought, amen, we have to be able to follow God's direction. Oh, God, you can't pick and choose, brother and sister. Amen. Because where God leads, he will provide for you there. God, Jesus. And so if he wanted to be sustained, he had to go to where God was leading him. He couldn't find another brook. He couldn't go to another city. He had to go where God was directing him. Are you hearing me, Lord Father? And so here it is. God tells him where to go. He tells him where to hide. He tells him, amen, that you shall drink from the brook. And he tells him, I have commanded the ravens to feed you there. So now, amen, he's in a season of drought, and God is giving him direction in the season of drought. God tells him, don't stay where you are, Elisha. Amen. I have made preparation for you. I have made provision for you someplace else. And if you get there, Elisha, everything is going to be all right. Elisha, amen, doesn't question God. He moves at God's word. The Bible said he goes to this place, and when he gets there, God, the Bible says, so he went and did according to the word of the Lord, for he went and stayed by the brook Cherith, which flows into the Jordan. The ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning, and bread and meat in the evening, and he drank from the brook. Because he obeyed the word of God, he was sustained by the word of God. Because he obeyed the word of God, amen, the Lord supplied, amen, all the needs that he needed at that time in his life. He told him to go to the brook of Cherith to hide. Remember that, to hide. He says, I want you to hide there. And then he tells him, I want you to drink from the brook. Then he tells him, I have commanded the ravens to feed you there. And so now God is saying to Elijah, I'm going to move you into a different space. I'm going to move you into a different season that is going to be uncommon, amen, to what you're familiar with. I'm going to do things that you have never seen done before. I'm going to supply for you in a way that you have never imagined before. As long as you abide by my word, as long as you go where I'm sending you, you will be taken care of in this hour. God, he gets there, and the Bible said that the ravens, which are unclean animals, they are bringing him meat and bread in the morning, and bread and meat in the evening. He's eating full meal twice a day. Praise God, because he's obeying the word of God. And many of us would have been turned off over the fact that a raven is feeding us. Many of us would have been turned off and said, Lord, no, if it's a raven, you can't feed me. I don't want that. Well, honey, if you don't eat from the raven, you're going to starve to death. Amen. And so we can't be picky in what God is doing. We got to allow God to do, amen, what he is capable of doing. You got to stop, amen, interfering with God's decisions. God, Father. And I believe that so many of us are interfering with God's decision. Amen. God is telling you where to go, and you are staying where you are. God is telling you where you need to go to hide, and you're staying where you are. Amen. And so here it is. He goes there. Amen. He obeys the word of God. But look at what happens. The Bible said, and it happened after a while that the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. I'm persuaded that many people, God, when this happened, becomes angry and frustrated at God. Because God, after all, you told me to go there, God. And we complain about how the resource is depleting. We complain over, man, how come the brook is drying up? We're complaining over, amen, how come the ravens are not dropping meat and bread anymore? We complain, oh God, when we see that our brook has dried up. Can I speak to someone who, amen, is at the brook of Cherith in their life? You are seeing your resource dry up, and you're wondering, how are you going to make it? God told me to tell you, amen, you have to stop looking at your resource and follow his direction. God is saying, if you're going to make it out of this, you have to stop looking at your resource and follow his direction. Lord God, the resource, amen, is only there temporary. Amen. The resource, God, is not for eternal. I've got to remember also that where you are, amen, I'm sending you there temporarily. God, Jesus. Sometimes we confuse our place of hiding, Lord God, with our place of dwelling. I'm going to say it again. Sometimes we confuse our place of hiding with our place of dwelling. God told Elisha to go there and hide. He never told Elisha to go there and dwell. And sometimes we become, amen, so comfortable at the place, God, that we're hiding in, that when everything is dried up and gone, amen, because the miracle happened there before, you're still waiting for God to do it again. But God is saying, I have moved on from there. Amen. Hallelujah. There is no more water there. There is no more raven there. There is no more bread there. There is no more meat there. I have moved on. I have transitioned from there. Oh God, look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor, don't get stuck at where God was. Be where he is. Now, I'm going to say that again. Don't get stuck at where God was. Be where he is. Too many of us are stuck where he was. Amen. We are reflecting on how things used to be. Amen. And we're hoping for those days to come back again. But I want to tell you, you can't get it where you are. You got to go where God is. Because if you stay where you are, amen, you're going to die there from starvation. Oh God, hallelujah. You got to move. Look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor, we can't stay here no longer. We got to follow God's direction. Elisha doesn't become confined to the brook of Cherith, where God's miracles and provisions were made available to him. He recognized that his season there has ended. Lord God, oh Father, he recognized that his season there has ended. Too many of us have an issue with recognizing when your season has ended where you are. God, and the reason why you're so frustrated is because your eyes is focused on the resource instead of focused on God and his direction. Not until you take your eyes off the resource and get your eyes on God and his direction, then you'll begin to move in the blessings that God has for you. Could you imagine if Elijah had stayed where he was? Elijah would have starved to death. He would have became malnourished. Amen. He would have withered away and died. But that was not Elijah's testimony. Oh God, the Bible says, then the word of the Lord came, amen, to him saying, arise, go to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and dwell there. So the Bible said, so he arose and went to Zarephath. Now, Zarephath was not a place where he ought to hide. Now, Zarephath was a place where he ought to dwell. And sometimes, like I said before, amen, we confuse our place of hiding, amen, with our place of dwelling. And we confuse our place of dwelling with our place of hiding. You got to know where God is leading you in this season. And so he's taking him from a place of hiding to now a place of dwelling. Because where he's hiding, his substance have run dry. Oh God, are you hearing me? Where you're hiding, your substance have run dry. And God sees that your substance have run dry. And how do I know that God is a loving God? Because God is already, amen, one step ahead of you. God has already given Elisha direction on where his next move is. Lord, hallelujah. He tells Elisha, he said, Elijah, he said, arise and go to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and dwell there. See, I have commanded a widow there to provide for you. So he arose and went to Zarephath. And the Bible said, when he came to the gate of the city, indeed a widow was there gathering sticks. He obeys the word of God. He moves after he realizes that where he is can't sustain him. He focuses not on his resource, but rather he focuses on God's direction. He gets up from where he is after seeing the brook dried up. He gets up from where he is after seeing that there is no more bread. And there is no more meat. He comes to his senses and says, Lord, I hear you. He arises when God says arise. And he goes towards Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon. When he gets to the place, oh God, the Bible said he sees a widow at the gate, gathering sticks. And he called to her and said, please bring me a little water in a cup that I may drink. So now he just want to make sure that this is the widow that God is talking about. She kindly obliged. She kindly accommodated him. And she was going to get him a cup of water. Then he calls out to her again. And he says, while she was going, can you get me, please, a morsel of bread in your hands? At this point, she stops in her tracks and she turns around to Elijah and she begins to pour out her heart to Elijah. She says, as the Lord your God lives, I do not have bread, only a hand full of flour in a bin and a little oil in a jar. And see, I am gathering a couple of sticks that I may go in and prepare it for myself and my son that we may eat it and die. Oh God. It takes a whole lot of faith after you have heard what this woman is saying to still believe in what God said. Because you would think that if the Lord has commanded this woman to provide for Elijah, she would have had an abundance of resource. God, stay with me. You would think that because the Lord had commanded this woman, that she would have known that Elijah was coming. But can I tell you? The Lord spoke over her, but she did not hear it audibly. Is it possible that God can speak over your life and you not know it? Is it possible that God can honor a word of blessing over your life while you're going through and you're thinking that oh God, it's going to be over, and God has spoken over your life and over your substance, letting you know that your best days are yet to come? God, she had no idea. She was gathering while God was speaking. Lord God, she was looking and preparing to die while God had uttered a blessing over her life. She had no idea. She had no inclination. Amen. That a word was spoken over her life. But Elisha got the word from the Lord. And Elisha held on to the word of the Lord. Elisha had to go beyond what he was hearing and what he saw for him to get what God had in store for him. Oh God, two of them had to activate faith. Elijah had to keep on believing her in spite of what she said. Because at that time, amen, many of us would have been like, okay, this is the wrong lady. Obviously, I must be at the wrong place. I must be at the wrong house. Because you, amen, don't have what God has told me that I needed to be taken care of. Amen. You don't have it, so then I must move on. Amen. But don't judge a book by its cover. Too many of us are judging book by its cover. Amen. Stop looking at the exterior of a thing and begin to understand God looks beyond the outward appearance and God goes into the heart. Too many of us are superficial. Everything we do is based upon the exterior. We got to look beyond, amen, the superficial. We got to look beyond the exterior and get to the heart of a thing. Oh God, Lord God, Elisha, in spite of what he heard, oh God, the woman gave her testimony. She said, man of God, as the Lord your God lives, I do not have bread, only a handful of flour. Now, everyone say a handful. Yeah, put your hand out right now and look at that, a handful of flour. She said, I only have a handful of flour, oh God, and a little oil in a jar. See, I am gathering a couple of sticks. You caught me, you came while I was preparing to die. You came at a season when I was calling it quits. You came at a season when I was about to turn off the light. Amen. And just, amen, look how wonderful God is. That God knows how to intercept, amen, your life. God knows how to walk in your life at a down, at a time where you, and believe you're going down. Amen. She was going down, but she didn't know that God was going to hold her up. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, somebody. It's shouting time. I said she was going down when she didn't know that God was holding her up. Oh, God, many of you are worrying over your resources, worrying that, man, you can't pay your bills. But, honey, you're not going down. Brother, you're not going down. God has come, amen, to give you direction for the season. God, you're not going down. If you're in the house with your family, amen, if you're on the job with your co-worker, it's okay. I give you permission to high-five them and tell them we're not going down. Yes, no matter how bad the situation is, amen, God has already spoken over your life. God has already, amen, spoken over your substance. God has already spoken over everything that pertains to you. You're not going down. Hallelujah. Oh God, and Elisha said to her, do not fear. Oh God, that's the word for this hour. Do not fear. I know what you're seeing. I know what it looks like. And you're wondering, how can you give me something from the little that you have? Lord God, you wonder how you can divide this, oh God, for three when you were preparing it for two. And you made it stretch for two because it was only good for one. And you're wondering, how am I going to, God, stretch this? And Elijah said to her, do not fear. That's Elijah faith kicking in as well. Elijah could have said, move on. He could have moved on to the next widow and tried to sort this thing out. But Elijah knew that this must be the woman. Elijah knew that in spite of how this woman looked, God's word was able to keep her. God's word was able to sustain her. God's word was able, amen, to hold her up in a time of drought. I want to tell somebody right now, I don't know who you are, amen, but you've been knocking your head, amen, you've been crying at night, you've been worrying and having anxiety and fear, but I've come to tell you, fear not. Fear not. Amen. He said, go and do as you have said, but make me a small cake from it first, and bring it to me, and afterward make some for yourself and for your son. Amen. I love this woman. This woman, amen, was obedient. She knew how to follow directions. She didn't fight with the man of God. She didn't challenge the man of God, but she obeyed the man of God. She saw something in Elijah, amen, that she didn't see in others. She saw something in Elijah. She recognized that he was a man of God. Oh God, she hung on to his word. And the Bible said, for thus saith the Lord, God of Israel, the bin of flour shall not be used up, nor shall the jar of oil run dry, until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth. Elisha opened his mouth and said, thus says the Lord. You got to know how to open your mouth when things don't look right. You got to know how to open your mouth when people, amen, are speaking negative against you. You got to learn how to open your mouth when your situation, amen, is fighting your belief. You got to open your mouth and say, thus says the Lord. God, Elijah opened his mouth and he spoke to her resource. Oh God, he said, thus is the Lord. He said, the bin of flour shall not be used up, nor shall the jar of oil run dry until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth. And the Bible says she went away and did according to the word of Elijah. Notice, people of God, she took her eyes off the resource. Amen. She had a little, but she shifted her focus. In this season of drought in America, you got to shift your focus. You can't focus on what's in your bank account. You can't focus on your unemployment check. You can't focus on how bad it is. You got to focus on God's direction. Because if God is going to sustain you in this hour, you got to focus on his direction. Lord God, once she shifted her focus, Lord God, things began to change. No doubt, I do believe that she was worrying even though she was making the cake. She didn't know how it was going to work its way out. Amen. But she obeyed and she did what the man of God told her to do. She went and baked him a cake first. Can you put God first this season? In spite of what you're dealing with, can you put God first? Can you begin to acknowledge him as Lord and say, Lord, I'm going to put you first. Not my desires, not the things that I want. I'm going to put you first because I need you to supply all my needs in this season. Oh, Father, help God. And she did as what Elijah told her to do. She baked him a cake first. And when she began to bake him a cake first, believe her, she began to pour out the flour. Amen. And she began to knead it. Amen. And she did what she had to do. And she baked him a cake. Oh, God. And when she poured it out again, Lord God, with the oil, she kneaded it. And she baked some more. I believe that as she was pouring, nothing was being depleted. Can I tell you that when you obey the word of God, amen, your substance will not be depleted in a time of drought. God will sustain it. God will hold you up in a season when everybody is going down. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm going up. I'm going up. God is going to sustain me in this hour. Amen. I refuse to be stuck, oh God, at a place where God has told me to move forward. I refuse to stay at the brook of Cherith when God has sent me to Zarephath. Notice, Lord God, that God told God Elijah, go to Zarephath and dwell there. That was the place where God wanted him to dwell in this season. Or sometimes the place where God leads you don't look like a blessing in the beginning. That small church with only a handful of members don't look like a blessing in the beginning. Oh God, that startup company that can only pay you, amen, what it can afford and not what you're worth, don't look like a blessing in the beginning. But can I talk to you about blessings in disguise? Oh God, it's not what it looks like, God is saying. He said, it's what I'll make it to be. Lord God, stop looking at what it is. And God is saying, I can make it to be a blessing. Oh God, if we can ever get past the place that we stop judging a book by its cover, Lord God, and start trusting in the leading of God. I don't know why you're sending me to this small church. I don't know why you're sending me to this job. I don't know why you're leading me to start a company, Lord, when I don't even have money. I don't know why, but you got to learn to trust God's direction. Because if we trust God's direction, he will provide, he will sustain us, and he will be our keeper. Oh, hallelujah. This woman went from nearly dying to living. Her situation changed when she encountered Elijah. She had no idea that she had a word spoken over her life. God didn't give her a vision. God didn't give her a dream. But God spoke a word. And she had no idea that a blessing was spoken over her life to sustain her, her son, and Elijah. You're looking at the little that you have, and you're worrying because you're looking at its size. But little is much if God's in it. As long as you got something, God can work with it. God is giving direction for this season. And he is saying, listen to what I'm saying. Take your eyes off your resource and focus on me. He said, I am the one that keeps you. I am the one that watches over you. I am the one that nurtures you. I am the one that keeps the death angel from you. I am the one. I know where you need to be. I know what you have need of. There is nothing that you're going through that I am not aware of. I know when your brook has dried up. I know when there is no bread. I know when there is no meat. I have not left you at Cherith. You refuse to move to Zarephath. I gave you direction, but you refuse to follow. But I want you to know I'm still in Zarephath. It's not too late to pick up and come. It's not too late for you to be refreshed. Yes, the brook of Cherith was a beautiful place. It was a blessed place. But I'm no longer there. I've moved on from there to Zarephath. That's where I'm providing my blessings. Don't live off past memories, wishing them to return at a place that you are. God is saying it's time to pick up from where you are. Wherever you are, a spiritual Lodabar, wherever you are, it's time to follow God's direction. Because once you get to Zarephath, it may not look like where you're coming from, but there is food there to keep you during drought season. I don't know who I'm talking to, but you're malnourished spiritually. There is no more bread. There is no more meat. There is no more water where you are. And God is saying it's time to take your direction from me. It's time to go to where I am and not stay where I was. Raise your hands wherever you are. And just begin to seek God's face. Begin to worship Him. Begin to magnify His name. He wants to see you restored. He wants to see you whole again. He wants to sustain you. He wants to keep you. Amen. He wants you to live and not die. I want to say thank you for allowing me to come into your home another Sunday. I pray that this word was a blessing to you. I pray that no matter who you are, if you have left the church, if you have gotten disgusted by the things that you have heard and saw, I'm saying to you, it's time to seek His face and get direction from the Lord. Because you can't stay out of God's presence. And expect to be filled. We have decided to do our own thing because we're just so turned off. Turned off with family. Turned off from friends. Turned off from church. We're just turned off altogether. But God loves you. He has done you no wrong. He's calling you to arise and go to Zarephath. Heavenly Father, I pray for every man and woman, every boy and girl. I pray that you cover your children, God. I pray, Lord God, that no matter where they are right now, Lord God, that you, Lord Father, would speak to them as you spoke to Elijah. Lord God, you gave him direction for this season, and we are seeking direction for our season. We pray, God, that we won't become stuck at a place where you're no longer at. But we will move in the direction of where you're going. And God, we will go with you as you go before us. We will obey your words, Lord Father. And we will worship you and magnify your name. I pray, God, that you keep your children. I pray for every backslider to come back home. I pray for every son to come back home. I pray for every daughter to come back home. I pray, Lord God, that in this season, that you will continue to knock on their hearts and let them know it's time to come back home. I pray, God, that they will not die where they are, but God, they will live where you're taking them. Keep your people, I pray, in this hour. Keep us, Lord God, from the death angel. Keep us, Lord God, from the evil one. Keep us, Lord God, even from our pride and our egos. Keep us, Lord God, that we will be able to be sustained by even the things that we look to be uncommon. And even unclean. Strip us, Lord God, from everything that will block us from receiving what you have for us. Once again, thank you. And Father, we adore you and we appreciate you. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank you for tuning in. May God bless you and keep you. May He cause His light to shine upon you. and give you peace now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. And amen. God bless you.